Hello guys, originally this video was planned to be the story of Alpina, but I didn't find much information online, so I'm going to make the video another time, because I'm going to buy this book called BMW Alpina. I wanted to ask if any of you happen to have a copy of this book, please let me know, so I can buy that from you, since most of the sellers that I found online didn't ship here in Albania. Back to the video now. When it comes to car designers and coach builders, not many stand out as much as Sbarro. Love it or hate it, Sbarro is one of the most original designers out there. A designer that always has done things in its own way. So guys, welcome back to another video, and here is the profile of Franco Sbarro. Francesco Sbarro was born in 1939 in Brescia, Italy. Son of a farmer, Sbarro showed interest in mechanics, especially for motorcycles and scooters. He would study Latin Greek in Lecce, and in 1957, at the age of 17, he settled in Neuchâtel, Switzerland, when he started working as a mechanic. 2 years later, Sbarro bought a small garage when he started working with a small German manufacturer called Borgward. In 1959, Franco would build his first prototype. The car was a mishmash of parts from different cars. The tubular frame was made by Sbarro, when he mounted a 2-liter Lancia V6 engine on the center, which was connected with a Volkswagen transmission. The first bodywork was made with parts of a Javel Jarret, but later on he would design its own body with polyester and fiberglass. Later on, he would redesign the car for a third time, with Borgward parts. It's obvious that the car isn't the best thing ever built, far away from being one. But considering that Franco was only 20 years old when he built this is something very impressive to say the least. In fact, this was so impressive that George Filippinetti, the owner of the legendary racing team Scuderia Filippinetti, hired Sbarro as a mechanic of the team. There, Franco would develop and maintain the cars of the team, the AC Cobra, the Ford GT40, and the Ferrari P3. While working for Filippinetti, Sbarro would build his first car in 1965. The Filippinetti one was based on a car Bankia. In 1965, Sbarro would build a race car powered by an NS2 1000cc engine, called Sbarro NS2 Barquette 1000. The interesting thing about this car is that the Barquette 1000 is one of the least favorite cars of Franco. He hates this car so much that he doesn't count this car as one of his creations. In 1967, Sbarro would build another car for Filippinetti, the Filippinetti 2, again based on a car Mangia. This car had a different nose with new headlights and without a front grille. Also, the rear end was new, with new fenders and new rear lights. Both cars were bought later on by Sbarro from Filippinetti. The biggest change for Sbarro would happen on March 25, 1968, when Sbarro left Scuderia Filippinetti and created its own design and coach building studio, called ACA, standing for Atelier du Construction Automobile. In a former cigarette factory, Sbarro started building all sorts of cars, from supercars and race cars to replicas. The first car would come in 1968, a coupe powered by a 4.7-liter Ford GT40 V8, called the Dominique III. This car was bought by a British businessman. Excited by this, Franco himself delivered the car in England by road. Originally, the Dominique was painted with British Racing Green, but after the hood was damaged during the delivery, the Dominique was painted white. Formula 5000 was a short-lived racing category, which was meant to be a low-cost open-wheel race series. for the new, and cars that no longer fitted in any particular formula. Many big names entered Formula 5000, like McLaren, Lotus, Lola and Mark. Sbarro also built a prototype for the 5000, which was powered by a 5-liter V8. The Sbarro Formula 5000 had 540 horsepower and could reach a top speed of more than 200. Around this time, Sbarro started converting and modifying race cars to street legal cars. One of his first conversions was the Bizzarini Isso Grifo A3C, when he replaced a Chevy engine for a GT41, because the owner couldn't stand the mechanical problems of the Chevy engine. Since Sbarro had worked with a GT40 while he was the chief engineer of the Scuderia Filippinetti, he was very familiar with the car. One of the first cars that came out from ACA was a race GT40, which was converted for road use. Also, Sbarro would restore many GT40s, but he is most known for his GT40 replicas. All Sbarro replicas are some of the best replicas out there. Even though I hate replicas, it's amazing to see how much work is put into this car. In fact, these cars were so similar with the original ones that would get him in lots of troubles. Like for example with the GT40 number 1048, which he had to restore it. But he sold this car without the original chassis plate. He used this plate for a replica, which he returned to the original owner of the 1048. A similar case happened with the GT40 number 1033. This led to many court cases against Sbarro. In 1968, Sbarro would build two Corvette L88 for the 24 Hours of Le Mans. Henry Grider and Bob Lutz convinced George Filippinetti to convert two L88s for the Le Mans race. So, Filippinetti brought Sbarro to assist on this project. Both cars participated on the 1968 Le Mans, and both cars dominated the GT class in the early hours of the race. But one of the cars left the race after the 6th hour, after some mechanical problems. The other car was retired after the 14th hour. In 1967, Eric Broadley, the founder of Lola, approached Sbarro to build a road-going version of his legendary car, Lola T70 MK3. Since the T70 was similar with the G40, Sbarro was the perfect guy for the job. The car was ready in 1969 and was painted in British Racing Green. After building the car, Sbarro started getting orders to build more cars like this. The interesting thing is that besides the Chevy engine, some of the cars were fitted with Ferrari V12 and Porsche Flat 6. Some of these cars were also quite luxurious inside, with leather and air conditioning. Around 13 Lola T70 MK3 were built in total. In 1969, Sbarro would build another GT40 based car, the Can-Am 4.7. This car was built for Scuderia Filippinetti and was used in some different races in Switzerland and Germany. 1 year after converting the L88, Sbarro would work again with General Motors, this time for converting two Opel GTs for rallying. The cars received a new tubular chassis and a new fiberglass body, but they failed to achieve any success, since engines were very The 60s were a time of experimentation for Sbarro, mostly restoration and race-to-road car conversion. The 70s on the other side were the years when Sbarro started creating his true identity and started building true unique cars. The first car of the 70s was the Can-Am 4.0, which was based on a Lola MK3, but not much is known about this car. But the first original Sbarro car built from the ground up would come only in 1973, when he presented two new cars at the Geneva Motor Show. The first car was Sbarro SV1, standing for Safety Vehicle 1. The chassis was connected to a tube with a double-sided roll cage, smacked into pieces of polyester filled with polyethylene foam. Franco decided to mount two NSU Wankel engines, building this way a 4-rotor one, with 300 horsepower at 5500 rpm, a similar technique that Chevy would use for their Corvette 4-rotor, which coincidentally was presented in 1973. The other car was the Sbarro Tiger, which basically was a Bertone Pantera knockoff. The Pantera was a prototype which was built by Bertone in 1968 for Scuderia Brescia Corse. Sbarro would return at Geneva Motor Show 1 year later, when he introduced the Sbarro Stash. The Stash had a similar chassis with the SV1, just the body had a more sporty design, and also a different engine. Instead of the 4-rotor engine, the Stash was available with a 4-cylinder 1.8-liter turbo engine and with a Mercedes 6.9 V8 one. Also, a Targa Stash was later on available. In 1978, Sbarro would present two of his most famous creations. The first one was the Windhound. The Windhound was based on Mercedes G-Wagon and was powered by a Mercedes 6.9 V8. So Sbarro was quite ahead of its time with this powerful, luxurious off-roader. The Windhound was available in 2-door and a 4-door version, but the option list was endless. The second 1978 car is the Sbarro Function Car, or TAG, how the car was named by the owner. The Function Car was based on a Cadillac Eldorado and was basically an office on wheel. This massive car was equipped with 4 armchairs, 4 phones, TV and a refrigerator. The Function Car was 7.2 meters long and weighed more than 3 tons, so Sbarro doubled the rear axle, making it a 6-wheeler. Originally the car was ordered by a Saudi businessman, but was bought again later on by Sbarro. But the TAG would not be the last 6-wheeler car built by Sbarro. Like I mentioned previously, the Windhound option list was endless, and the most interesting Windhound is the King Khalid version. The King liked the Windhound, but he also liked falconry. So he asked Sbarro to build a Windhound that was capable of going full speed over the sand dunes of Saudi Arabia, but also would allow him to hunt without leaving the car. Sbarro came up with a 6-wheeler Windhound, called the Windhawk. All the 6-wheelers were driven, and combining them with a 6.9-liter V8, this monster could reach a top speed of 190 km per hour. The Windhawk had an adjustable ground clearance, 25 to 42 cm, and a 350 petrol tank. The top of the car was removable, and the seats could be raised hydraulically 80 cm, so it would be easier to hunt. The last 70s car was a Bugatti Royale replica. Sbarro coupled two rubber V8 engines to form a V16 one. This car was the closest thing you would get to the original one, but what you can accept for a replica that costed 300,000 Swiss francs. The only reason why the owner didn't buy the original one is that he wanted air conditioning and bulletproof windows. While in the 70s Sbarro created his true identity for weird and quirky cars, the 80s were the years when he made his craziest creation. With crazy money coming from Arabia and America, Sbarro built some true bizarre cars. The first 80s cars was another falconry car, this time a Rolls-Royce Camargue. This car lost the roof, together with the front and rear bumper. The Super 12 is one of the most bizarre Sbarro cars. Similar in size with the Austin Mini, the Super 12 was powered by two Kawasaki V6 1300cc engines. Each engine had its own 5-speed gearbox, and a special linkage system allowed the boxes to be operated synchronously with a single gear lever. Since each engine powered only one wheel, the car could be run on one engine only. The total power output was 240 horsepower, and with a weight of only 800 kilos, the Super 12 could accelerate from 0 to 100 in under 5 seconds. The Super 12 was followed by another crazy hatchback, this time a Porsche 928 dressed up on a Volkswagen Golf body. With 310 horsepower, the Golf 300S could reach 100 kilometers in under 7 seconds, and had a top speed of 230 km per hour, making it a perfect wolf in sheep clothes. But the 300 wasn't the last Golf to come out from Sbarro. The Golf Turbo was even crazier. The coolest feature of this car is how the rear could be raised up, thanks to a hydraulic system. Sbarro applied this extravagant system because it was more practical to work with the engine. The Golf Turbo was powered by a 911 turbo engine with 330 horsepower. The only visible modification are the two side air intakes, so the turbo was an even better sleeper than the 300S. Sbarro Shaheen is one of the most famous Sbarro creation. Built at a time when 1000 SALs were coalescing on the world, the Shaheen was one of the wildest cars of the time. New body kit together with the Sbarro 80s grille, galling doors and a new interior. Basically everything you wanted. Except if you wanted more power. This was the case with a Saudi customer. So Sbarro built a biturbo. The foundation was the same with a Sbarro Shaheen. Franco kept the 5-liter engine, but gathered into it a pair of turbos, which increased the power from 231 to 350 horsepower, making it one of the fastest Grand Tours on the market. Also, the car looked like it was from Mad Max. Also, another Mad Max look-alike car was a 1000 SAL, which had 4 galling doors, showing again how crazy Sbarro really was. Sbarro built only one Super 12, since the car was totally crazy. 3 years later, he presented another similar car, the Super 8. The bodywork was the same, with some minor changes here and there. The biggest change was the engine. Sbarro abandoned the Kawasaki engine for a Ferrari 3-liter V8 from a 308. With 260 horsepower, the Super 8 could reach a top speed of 220 km per hour. But the most known Sbarro car would only come in 1985, when he presented the Challenge. Presented for the first time at the 1985 Geneva Motor Show, the Challenge amazed the public with its wedge-shaped design. The first Challenge came with a Mercedes twin-turbo V8 with 350 horsepower. Combining this with a drag efficiency of 0.26, the Challenge could reach a top speed of 300 km per hour. The interior wasn't as special as the exterior of the car, but had some very cool features, like two TV monitors, which were mounted near the doors. These TVs were connected with side cameras, which replaced the side mirrors. In 1986, Sbarro would build another Challenge, called the Challenge 2+2. The car had two additional seats. And instead of the Mercedes V8, the car now had a Porsche 930 turbo engine. In 1987, he built the final version of the Challenge 3. This car also came with a 930 turbo, but it had 400 horsepower. In 1985, he also presented the Brescia, a BMW-powered car which looked like the 1960s car, and the Renault Super 5. The 1986 would not see many releases from Sbarro, mostly some replicas, with the most notable one being a Ferrari P4 replica, which was based on a 300 GTS. The other 1986 car was the Citroën Adventure, which was kinda like a USV, basically a lifted C15 with Sbarro styling. But if the Adventure was a small USV, the Monster G was another story. Ordered by a German client, the Monster G came with a 6.4-liter engine, producing 350 horsepower, making it one of the most powerful off-roaders of the market. If the design wasn't crazy enough, Sbarro equipped its Monster with a set of Boeing 747 wheels. The Sbarro Robur was presented in 1988. And was another crazy hatchback. This car was built for a French businessman who wanted a small city car, but in the same time a car that had the power of a sport car. The Robur was mid-engine and was powered by an Audi 205-cylinder turbo engine, producing 200 horsepower. The car was very small, measuring at only 3.3 meters long and just 1.2 meters tall. But like most Sbarro cars, the Robur was quite wide, measuring in 1.8 meters. The Robur was also packed with some really interesting features. For example, at the rear were two small wheels that could be extended, lift the car and move it, so it would be easier to park the car on a small space. Also, Robur came with a brake spoiler, that was activated at a speed of 220 km per hour. But Sbarro isn't just a designer, he is also an inventor, and in 1989 he presented one of his most famous inventions, the hubless or orbital wheel. Two vehicles were presented together with the orbital wheel. The first one was the Osmos, which was basically a giant Hot Wheels powered by a Jaguar V12. The other was a motorcycle which was called Orbital Wheel. The motorcycle showed the wheels in much better way. Seats also connection were on the left sides, and the right side was completely clean. In the 90s, many changes happened. Since in 1992, Sbarro opened his design school, called Space Sbarro. So most of the cars that came after 1992 were built by Sbarro and his students. The first car of the 90s was the Chrono, which was built for one thing only, to reach 100 km per hour as quickly as possible. Chrono needed only 3.5 seconds to reach 100. This was done thanks to a ultra-lightweight body and a BMW M1 with 500 horsepower. In 1991, Sbarro would present another invention, the dual frame. The dual frame was formed by two parts, first module, which is the mechanical module, with all the mechanical parts and the rolling structure, and the second module, which is the body. The biggest advantage of the dual frame is the weight. A car with a dual frame could be built weighing between 800 to 1100 kilos. The first car to use the dual frame was the Helios, a car that had a similar design with the Osmos, and like Osmos, the Helios was powered by a Jaguar V12. The first car of Space Sbarro was the Astro. This car was a special order by a Swiss ophthalmologist. He wanted an aggressive looking car with a Ferrari engine and with a top of the range electronics. The Osmos was followed by Isatis, which was a car that was designed by the students of Sbarro. Even though the car had a BMW V12, the car was just a model and wasn't functional. Same year, Sbarro together with his students presented Urbi, a small electric car. In 1994 came the Oxalis. The Sbarro Oxalis is a pure roadster, no hood, no side windows, only a small tilted windscreen. The body was made out of composite materials. Thanks to this, Oxalis weighed only 800 kilos. The power came from a BMW M5 engine, with 315 horsepower. Also, in 1995, Sbarro presented an Alfa Romeo prototype. This was a wagon version of the 155 Q4. Sadly, the car never made it to production. 1 year later, one of the best Sbarro works was presented. With a striking design and with a Testarossa engine, the Alcadar was just amazing. Sbarro and his students would work again with Alfa Romeo in 1996. Sbarro got a special request from Walter da Silva and Mario Fiorilla from Centro Stile Alfa to build a special roadster. Sbarro came up with Alfa Romeo Issima, a beautiful roadster which combined the retro styling with a modern one. Besides the scissor doors, the most interesting thing about Issima is the engine. Sbarro wasn't satisfied with the power that the Busso produced, so he coupled two Busso 3-liter V6 to form a 500 horsepower V12. The 1997 would be quite a busy year for Sbarro, since he introduced all sorts of cars, from Citroën Specialized for photographers and body kits for the Peugeot 106 to Crazy Quads. The Formula Ring was an open-wheel car powered by a Peugeot V6 with 200 horsepower. Weighing at only 600 kilos, the Rin was for sure a fun car to drive. The Rin was followed by an even lighter open wheeler, the Between, which used a straight 4 1.6 liter with 140 horsepower. The most interesting 1997 car is definitely the Sbarro Ionos, which was a tribute to Lancia Stratos. Sbarro didn't use the V6 like the original Stratos had. Instead, he went and used two Lancia straight 5 engines to form a V10 with 500 horsepower. The engines were from Lancia Kappa, the transmission from a 911 and the brakes from DTM. The final 97 car was the Sbarro Hommel Berlinette, a car that was built for Michel Hommel. In 1998, most of the cars were modified cars. The only car that wasn't a modified one was the Subaru Crylis. Subaru was inspired by the Peugeot 416 for this car. And when I say inspired, he only took the front and the rear lights to build this car. The Crylis had a more aerodynamic design, was mid-engine and was a hardtop convertible. This project was continued with the Crylis Corse, which was a truck version of the car. But this car didn't went beyond the clay model. The other cars that he presented in 1998 were a body kit for Citroën Xara and Berlingo Callao, which was basically a 90s version of the Fiat 500 Jolly. But the most interesting cars were the Renaults. First was the Megane, which was powered by a V6 engine from a 406. But instead of being on the front, the engine was located behind the seats, making the car even more exciting. The other Renault was the Spider, which was a Spider version of the S-Pace. Again, the 194 horsepower V6 engine was used. This car was built for the 1998 Le Mans Parade. The 1999 again would see a mix of tuned and original cars. The two tuned cars were the Renault Clio Top Chop, which had a lower roof, and the Volkswagen Golf Folitec, which was based on a Golf MK4 GTI. The Golf Folitec was basically a marketing machine for Foliatec, since the car was built for Foliatec and used 26 Foliatec parts. But the coolest 99 car is definitely the GT1. The GT1 was built to celebrate the victory of Mercedes at Le Mans. The power came from a Mercedes V8 with 450 horsepower, which helped the car to reach 100 km in under 5 seconds and allow it to reach a top speed of more than 325 km per hour. For the new millennium, Subaru continues the GT1 project, this time using a 6-liter V12 with 500 horsepower. The GT12 was followed by the B-motor, or Scorpio. The idea behind B-motor was simple, a car that would be bent on corners like a motorcycle. An idea quite popular at the time with car likes Mercedes F300 and F400. The B-motor was powered by two Yamaha straight 4 engines, and each of the engines drove one of the rear wheels. Some other cars of the 2000s were the Minotaur, a BMW V12 powered convertible, Charan Sahara, a convertible Charan, Citroën Berlingo, a young cruiser, a 6-wheeler Berlingo, Citroën Berlingo Taxi, a Berlingo that was inspired from the London Black Cabs, and Scorpio Rowland. In 2001, Subaru would present again another GT1 version, this time coming as convertible, and with a Ferrari engine. The Seb Millennium was based on a Ford Mustang, which made it even more similar with a Cubale Mangusta. Some other 2001 cars were the Seat Leon Coupe, which was another front-to-mid-engine conversion, the Subaru Wolf Shark, which was a Roadster powered by Audi V8, and Dodge Dakota. Like the others, Subaru adopted the retro Art Deco look of the early 2000s, and Dakota is what he came up. The 2002 would be quiet year for Subaru, when all the cars that he introduced were tuned cars, like the XX5, which was a X5 without iconic BMW grille, a white body 550 Maranello, the Citroën Picasso Cup, which started as a good idea, a powerful truck focused MPV. The original plan was to put a 400 horsepower engine, but since PSA didn't have any 400 horsepower engine, they put a 250 horsepower one. The last 2002 car is the weirdest one. The first moment I saw this car, I thought Top Gear, since the car looks so similar with a Richard Hammond MG limousine. Not much is known about this car, besides the fact that it was based on a Daimler. 2003 would be an important year for Subaru, since he presented another invention. The idea behind this invention was again very simple. Since wheels are getting bigger and bigger, why we don't put the mechanics inside the wheel? This way, more space would be available for the passengers. Not much is known how this system really works, but Subaru presented three vehicles. The first one, the UMA-1, was a motorcycle. The UMA-2 was a three-wheeler, the UMA4 was a modern-looking Challenge. The GT HDI was built with Peugeot parts, including the engine which was a 2.2-liter HDI. And if you are similar with the 307, you probably have noticed the front and the rear lights. Also, a truck version of the GT HDI called the GTR was presented. Instead of the straight 4 engine, the GTR used a V6 with 202 horsepower. 2004 would see some quite interesting cars, like the Roadster V12, which was a retro-inspired car powered by a Jaguar V12. Another retro-inspired car was the Turbo Rhino, but this time the inspiration came from a series of French comic books called Spyro. Also, another car that was presented in 2004 is the SB1 Tornado, which was based on a 550 Maranello, which had undergone major changes. But the most interesting car of the 2004 is only interesting for all the wrong reasons. The Mercedes SL Roadster is one of the worst Subaru works. This car was based on an SL R129 and had received a terrible body kit. A body kit that looks like was done by someone who had zero knowledge about car design. Probably two cars were built, a blue one and a weird pink one, which made the car to look even weirder. Not many releases in 2005, a V6 mid-engine, Citroën C2, Mille Miglia, a car inspired by the Ferrari of the 50s, and the SB2 Tornado, which was the evolution of the SB1. The SB2 looked much better than the SB1, since some of the lines were fixed, plus the car looked better in red. In 2006, Subaru presented some awesome and some terrible cars. He did the same thing that he did with the SL, but this time with the 360 Modena. The first car was a black one, but apparently someone liked the car in the same pink color that Subaru used for the SL. The GT8 basically looked like a cheap replica. Subaru also built another Mille Miglia and a mid-engine Citroën C1. But in 2006 he also presented one of his best works, probably his best work, the Alfa Romeo Diva. The Diva was a collaboration between Subaru and head of Centro Stile Alfa, Wolfgang Egger, which is the guy who designed the 8C. The Diva was inspired from the legendary Tipo 33 Stradale, and Subaru did a good job with not just making a copycat. Diva was based on a 159 and was powered by a 3.2 Busso from a 147 GTA. The most interesting 2007 car was a Turbo S20, a Roadster with smart Roadster headlights and Fiat 600 rear lights, and with an engine from A500. 1 year later, Subaru presented the Alcador GTB, which basically was a coupe Turbo S20. Another difference was that Turbo S20 was a tubular frame, and the Alcador was based on a 348 GTB. The Alcador was followed by Pendocar, a quad that could bend like a two-wheel motorcycle, the Katana, a two-seater powered by a VTEC engine, and the Mousseline, a truck-focused car powered by a Citroën 2-liter engine. From 2010 until now, Subaru has built a number of different cars, mostly truck-focused cars, electric cars, and hot rod-inspired cars. In 2010, Subaru presented one of its most controversial design, the Autobau. The Autobau was criticized for the weird design, especially for the weird front and the 70s style. The rear isn't as bad as the front. Also, the side looks like it was inspired from the Ferrari Modulo designed by Pininfarina. The power of Autobau came from a Ferrari V12 with 500 horsepower. On the other side, the Subaru Essenza looked pretty good. To me, it looks like a small Dodge Viper, especially with a long hood and a double bubble roof. But differently from the Viper, the Essenza was powered by a BMW Straight 6 with 200 horsepower. No, it's not a Lamborghini concept, but a Subaru one, built by him and his students in only 4 months. the Evoluzione was a three-seater speedster, when the driver's seat was positioned on the center, like a McLaren F1. The sad thing is the engine. The Evoluzione was powered by Audi Straight 4, 1.8-liter with 108 horsepower. The 2x100 looks like a car that has come straight out from a cartoon series, with a funky design. The name 2x100 means 2 liter for 100 km. Sbarro managed to achieve these stats thanks to a 600cc engine and the aerodynamic shape of the car. In 2012, he presented Intensity, an electric car. Memory, a Ferrari 250 GTO replica, based on a Ferrari 408, a hot rod powered by a Maserati V8, with 360 horsepower. The car was named 8 because the car was built in only 8 weeks. In 2012 came the Reactive, a hybrid coupe powered by a Peugeot V6 and two electric motors. The Jacqueline was another car that followed the style of the SL Roadster and the GT8. This time, Sbarro used the Jaguar XK as a base. But differently from the previous car, the Jacqueline looked awesome. The S13 French Rouge was another aggressive looking car. But like with the Evoluzione, the amazing design went down because of the engine, a straight 4 from a Citroën DS3. In 2014 came the Sbarro Sparta, a rally hybrid, and the Grand Prix, another hot rod, this time with a BMW V12, with 300 horsepower. 2015 saw some great releases, like Sbarro Aira, a beautiful coupe powered by a Subaru 2-liter boxer with 217 horsepower. Familia was also as beautiful. Familia was built to celebrate Mille Miglia, and the design was inspired from the cars of the 50s. The weird thing is that Sbarro went for a Porsche V8, even though the car looks like it was inspired from the retro Ferraris. 2016 saw Geneva, a 2-seater speedster, and Haze, truck car powered by Audi Straight 5 with 300 horsepower. The students of Sbarro built this car in only 2 months, something that is mind-blowing. And the Arcadar, a matte beach buggy powered by a 300 horsepower Cadillac V8. This year, Sbarro and his students have presented Mojave, another hot rod powered by a Jaguar V8. In the end, Sbarro is a great designer, of course with his ups and downs, but is a special designer which always would amaze you with his crazy creations. Plus, he is not just a designer, he is also an engineer, like he said.
Do you count yourself as being an engineer or a stylist?
No, concepteur.
No, I'm interested in the whole concept. Because you find the quintessence of the craftsman, the engineer, the stylist and the designer, and all that in one. In a car, you've got to be able to capture the psychology of the person behind the wheel.
You can see Sbarro cars in different car collections, like the Lovman Museum in Netherlands, Autobau Museum in Switzerland, and the Rainbow Sheikh car collection. Most of the Sbarro cars are still owned by him, and are displayed on his design school. So you rarely see Sbarro cars to pop up for sale. And those that show up for sale, most of the times are Sbarro replicas, and they are not cheap.